morning. All right. Well, do me a favor. If you know of a family and you want to nominate a family for gifts this year, would you put a G on your card and turn your card in today, please, with your name, and I'll make sure that Kevin gets with you. And we can get all the information, or the secretaries will get with you, and they'll fill out a card. We'll put that card on that Christmas tree, and then next week we'll have hopefully a few left over after the first service where we can actually do some giving as well. Really love what God's doing in our church, the giving hearts that are here, and the generosity that flows from all of you. So thank you so much. Well, we're talking today. We're in God's Gifts for Us. This is the series that during the Christmas season. I like to talk about the gifts that we have because of Jesus. These are not gifts that we get because we are human. These are gifts that we get because we belong to Christ. Okay? So when the first one we talked about, our gift of family. God gave us a gift of family like the rest of the world when we were born into this world. They were our gift. Like it or not, that was the gift we got, right? That's where we went home to. That's who took care of us. Some of us might have bounced around from family to family as we were growing up. And everyone determines for themselves who they want to consider family and who they won't. Irregardless, that's the world we live in, right? That's what family looks like. It's blended. Grandma raises me. Maybe it's a foster care. Who knows? Maybe I was adopted as a baby. Maybe I've got three sets and four sets of parents, and those kinds of things. Or two parents, but three or four sets of grandparents because of divorce and remarriage. Listen, guys, that's everybody gets that kind of thing. Everyone doesn't get the same gift, but everybody does get the gift of family. But what we are talking about, mostly when we're talking about the gift that Jesus brought when he came, is each other. The gift of a spiritual family, of being part of a local body of believers, and how God wants to use us in each other's lives as he blesses us and reminds us through the way we love each other that he loves us. And so that was a good message, and I really think that if you haven't seen these, you should go online to GCCJohnstown.com and look at the media section and look at the first couple of messages. Last week, we talked about God's gift of peace and how everyone who is saved gets that peace. And the first time we open it is the moment we get saved, when we realize that our sin separates us from God, but then we also feel his love pour into our life, his forgiveness pour into his life, his grace pour into our life, and we feel the release of all of that as far as it no longer separates us from him. That's peace. That's peace with God while I live in a world that has really peace that comes and goes depending on how my week's going, right? So everybody has the other kind of peace. We want the peace that comes from Christ, and we talked about that, and that comes to every Christian. But what we're talking about today is the gift of joy. Okay, how many of you know that you feel joy when a new baby is born into the family? Grandparents for the first time or anything like that, right? All right, and then last week we had a baptism, and the person was baptized. I could hear the joy, everybody cheering when Justin was baptized, right? And so we have this sense of joy that all of us have as a Christian, okay? I'm joyful because that's my granddaughter. I'm joyful because that's my brother or that's my sister that's being baptized, and they're publicly professing Christ to the world and are letting everybody know that they're part of my family, and I'm here joining God, letting them know they're part of mine. Is one of the major reasons that God had us do baptism, water baptism, is because it isn't the water baptism that saves us, but the baptism of Jesus. And when that baptism comes into our life, the Holy Spirit comes into our life, we are his child forever. And then everything from that point on is determined as far as kingdom for us. We're no longer outside of the kingdom, we're inside of the kingdom. We're allowed to participate in the things that God is doing in this world. That's living in the kingdom. Participating. So when I participate in what God is doing in my family, I'm participating in the kingdom. When I'm just being selfish in my family, not so much. I don't care if you're the pastor or not. Same's true for you as anyone else. When I'm joining God at work, then I am participating in the kingdom at work. When I am just doing like everybody else, just earning a paycheck and not really caring about anybody there, then I am not so much living in the kingdom at work. And it can change, of course, the way you even look at your workplace when you start living in the kingdom. So this gift of joy are not just for people who are saved, but people who actually live in the kingdom of God as they go through life. In other words, they're not waiting to start joining God when they die and go to heaven, but we're joining God today. We're joining him in our thoughts and in our words and in our actions, right? So today's message, this gift of joy is not for every Christian. Okay? It is not like peace, which is for every Christian. Now, does God want every Christian to have this gift of joy? Yes. And let me make that clear. Nobody that's a Christian is in God's family where God does not want you and to experience what we're about to talk about. But Jesus said in the kingdom of God that only certain people could experience this joy. And as your pastor who loves you and wants you to experience this joy, I'm going to tell you all about it today, okay? I'm going to tell you all about it. I'm going to tell you how to have it, how to have that, to find that joy, and then how to help others have that joy. Not from Bob's ideas, but from the Word of God. But before we go there, I want to go to what Jesus said about this joy. It's found in John 15:11, not on your notes. John 15:11, go ahead and put it up, Brooke. And so let's read that. I have told you these things so that you can have the same joy I have, and so that your joy will be the fullest possible joy. So what I'm teaching today is the fullest possible joy that Jesus calls the same joy that he had while he walked this earth. It is the joy that took him through the cross, because the scriptures very clearly say he was looking ahead to the joy in our lives, seeing us being able to walk with God, that allowed him and empowered him and motivated him to go to the cross and face death for you and me. So this joy is a joy that we can have no matter what's going on in our life. How many of you know that there are passages in the New Testament, James and Peter, Hebrews, where they say, count it pure joy when you face troubles of many kinds, right? And then it goes on to tell us a couple of reasons why. But we're not going to find this joy when the reasons that we're going through this problem is because we were selfish. All right? We were disobeying God and we did something and now we're going to jail. We're not going to find joy in that. That's not what they're talking about. What they're talking about is if I am serving God and I am suffering or paying a price for it, then I can find this joy in that. And here's why. So that I won't give up and I will keep persevering in that situation or in that, and I continue to serve God. So when you look at that verse here, I want you to know that it comes from John 15, and he says, I have told you these things. Here's what he's told you, right? He's told you, I am the vine, you are the branch. If a man remains in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. So he's talking about walking with him, not knowing about him, but knowing him, remaining in him, walking with him, to the point that we're bearing fruit. And then he says, this is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples, showing that you don't learn from Pastor Bob, you learn from me. Okay? And so this is what he's talking about in John 15. He goes on in John 15, and he says that, I no longer call you servants. Okay? Jesus said he did not come to be served, but to... You all know that, right? He said that, right? I did not come to be served, but to serve. Okay? So he's not saying we're not a servant in chapter 15, but he's saying I no longer call you servants. I call you friends. Because now you know my Father's business. Right? So we can serve Jesus as a servant, or we can serve with Jesus as a friend, right? And so what he's saying is, I told you these things so that you can have joy in your service, so that you can have joy in your life as you remain in me. And of course, we know that can't remain in him if we don't deny ourselves, take up our cross, and follow him, right? If we don't love him more than we love ourselves, we cannot follow him. It's an impossible task for the most saved Christian. We're all saved the same, but just in case you got it in your head that a Billy Graham might be more saved than you, he's not. He can't follow Jesus any more than you or I can if we don't deny ourselves and take up our cross first. Taking up our cross, simply being willing to think what God wants me to think, say what God wants me to say, do what God wants me to do. That's what it meant for Jesus. That's what it means for us, serving God, with God. Jesus said the Son can do nothing on his own. He can only do what he sees his Father doing. And he told us we can do nothing on our own. We can only bear fruit if we walk with him and remain in him. Amen? So that's the basis of this message. Paul teaches about this joy. And he teaches it in Philippians chapter 2, and that's where we're going to spend the rest of this morning in. Chapter 2, verses 17 through 30. I hope you've got notes. We're going to talk about, and he's going to show us how to find joy. First and foremost, the foundation of finding this joy is, number one, be ready to serve God faithfully. Write that down. Be ready to serve God faithfully. Now, what do I mean by that? You can't serve God faithfully if you can't see God. You can't serve God faithfully if you can't hear God. You can't serve God faithfully if you don't know what God is doing. Okay? Can't be done. Because in the Bible, faithfully means I know what God wants and I'm joining God in it. Okay? Moses. It wasn't faith that he had his child circumcised. You might know that God was threatening the life of his child as he was going to free the Egyptians. And it was his wife, who was not from Israel, who said, you need to honor God and do what God established with Abraham. And then he circumcised his children. And he didn't act in faith until his wife reminded him that this is what God wants from you, to set apart people he has chosen so that you remember that you are set apart. So even his own children, while he was there, and before God called him out of his luxury that he was living in with his father-in-law and his family, and called him to be a servant by freeing the Israelites, it was God speaking to him in a bush, him coming to know what God wanted. And then, did Moses do a single thing? Did Moses, was it his staff, or was it God, and Moses doing what God wanted him to do with that staff that caused all those things to happen? See, God does not want man to do things. Why? Because it's not good for us when God does something through us and we take the credit for it. Can I say that again? It's not good for us when God does something through us and we take the credit for it. Because more than likely, if I'm taking the credit for it, God was never in it in the first place. In other words, if I'm going to attribute to me the goodness that is in me, then I'm not going to attribute it to Jesus. Right? So this level of servanthood cannot be accomplished by a Christian who doesn't love God. And how do we know this? Philippians 2:17. Here's what Paul says. But I will rejoice even if I lose my life, pouring it out like a liquid offering to God, just like your faithful service is an offering to God. And I want all of you to share that joy. Circle the word that. Paul wants you to share that joy. What is that joy that Paul wants me to share? It is joy that comes from offering my life out to God. And he's using a picture of a liquid offering or a drink offering from the Old Testament. He's just using it as a picture. He's not telling everybody to go apply the Old Testament to their life. He's saying, picture this, and this is what they would have pictured. Picture an altar that's very hot, and you pour an offering, a liquid offering, on those hot stones. What's going to happen? It immediately dissipates, and it's gone. No longer to be seen, right? And it's a picture. As I am pouring my life out, serving God, right? I am rejoiced in it. I find this joy there in that service. And how do we know that? Because he says it again, only instead of speaking about himself, he's now speaking about them. And he says, in the same way, or just like your faithful, circle the word faithful, your faithful service is an offering to God. And I want all of you to share the joy, that joy that comes from serving and genuinely offering yourself as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God, because this is your spiritual act of worship. This is what Paul teaches in Romans, the person that's writing this letter. So he's making it very clear to us in this statement, in these two sentences, that there is a joy that comes from serving faithfully, meaning I know what God is doing and I'm joining him. There's a joy that comes from that no matter how many things go wrong, I'm going to still have that joy to sustain me and carry me through the cross. Carry me, in his case, through jail and through beatings and through stoning, and us through family leaving us, friends leaving us, fellow Christians leaving us. Okay? The things that kind of make us want to quit. Quit what? Serving God faithfully. Okay? I can't quit on my marriage without faith. Quitting on God. I can't quit on you without quitting on God. I can't quit on my enemy without quitting on God. I have to say to God, I'm not going to faithfully serve you in that life. Well, that heart doesn't serve God. That heart serves self. That heart says, God, I will serve your people when it suits me and when I benefit from it. But if I have to pay a price for it, I'm going to go find someone else to serve. So this is a joy that doesn't come to everyone because not everyone serves. And it is even those who serve it doesn't come to you because you're serving for other reasons. than because you're remaining in Christ. Because Jesus said that we would face the same sufferings he did if we remained in him. Did he not? Yeah, and he faced everything I just mentioned a minute ago. So the first thing, the foundation of this, if I'm not serving, if I'm not saying yes to the Lord in my home, if I'm not saying yes to the Lord at work, if I'm not saying yes to the Lord as I go through life, if I'm not the faithful servant wakes up saying, Lord, what are we doing today? The unfaithful servant says, I'll get around to you on Sunday or Wednesday, or I'll get around to you all, you know, at this class or at this worship. No. The faithful servant says, Lord, what are we doing today? I want to walk with you today. I want to be a part of what you're doing in this world, and the world that I'm touching is the world that you're touching through me, if I will serve you. And if I serve you, I can have this joy that Paul is talking about. So that's the first thing, to have the joy. But the second thing is this. Unlike peace, peace is something that I get. And you might see my peace, and you'll benefit because I treat you better when I'm at peace. Amen? So you may see that peace, and you may benefit from it, but I can't share that peace from you because it's not my peace to be shared with you. It's not given to me to be shared with you. But this joy is given to me to be shared with others who serve God. Okay? And so that's why you think, well, you come to Grace and you wonder, well, how come there's so much joy in these people's lives? You know, and things are going wrong. I guarantee you, if you see someone, whether it's at your work, who's a Christian or here as a Christian, and bad things go through their life, and they're still joyful, and they're still serving God at work and still serving God at church, it's because they want you to see that, and they're sharing, hopefully they're sharing their joy with you. And we see that in number two. Let others see your joy is what Paul says in Philippians 2:18, the next verse. He says, yes, you should rejoice, and look what he says, and I will share your joy. So while nowhere in the scriptures does it say I can share your peace, the peace you get from Christ, we can see very clearly here I can share your joy and you can share mine. Okay, so this is a little bit different than that God's gift of peace. So not only is it a gift that I want to have and open up as I serve God and I join him in whatever he's doing, but I can, and things go hard and they're difficult for me, when I find that joy, I'm supposed to rejoice and I'm supposed to, what, share that joy with you. And when you find that joy, you're supposed to share that joy with me. And this is ultimately how God keeps his children serving. He doesn't keep us serving by putting a whip to us. He keeps us serving by pouring his joy into our lives. And then we share it with each other. And so let me give you a real example of that. If I'm serving God and all of a sudden I just don't want to serve anymore because everything's going wrong in my life, you know, and I just don't want to make myself available anymore and I'm just upset. The reason that you share your joy with me is that I might realize that I don't have to stay where I'm at. And the answer isn't for God to fix my life. The answer is for me to just refine my joy so that I will keep serving him. And your sharing your joy helps me be mine. And you can see this in this whole letter. Paul is trying, he's letting them know that their joy is helping him stay joyful in jail. He's in jail in Rome, right? And he's letting them know that, and he's trying to share with them his joy so that they too will have joy. For what purpose? For what end? Not so they can go around, oh, we're so joyful, we're the joyful people. No. So that, no, I'm not quitting no matter what. You can keep doing what you're doing to me, I'm going to keep loving you. Because I can't serve God and quit on you. That's joy. Joy doesn't look like this. Joy comes from a broken heart, comes from a beaten body. Joy comes from being on a cross and knowing, though, that he could have come off that cross at any time. You know that, right? And what they're saying in Hebrews is he was looking forward to you and I, the joy of looking at you and I that kept him on that cross. And that's the joy we're talking about. This is not a joy that I'm celebrating and let's all pop a bottle of champagne and celebrate. This is a joy that I'm at the very probably lowest part of my life from a human perspective, but I'm still serving God, and there's a joy in my heart that keeps me serving God. And what is that? You. You. And the next generation that is going to serve God because of you. Well, nobody's going to serve God because of me, Bob. Well, let's get that changed. Well, how do you want to get that changed, Bob? Oh, I want to whip you. No, I want you to find the joy that I've found so that serving God becomes as something that you will never let go of. You'll never go through a difficulty again and not open the gift of joy you have because you walk into that problem serving God and you refuse to stop serving God while you are in that problem because of the joy, which is very real, that He gives you. Okay? And so that's the foundation of finding the joy. Number one, I've got to know what it is. I hope you know what it is now, finding this joy this Christmas. And it's a matter of serving God faithfully and letting other people see my joy. And number three, it is also me being interested in how God uses you. We need to be interested in how God uses others. If I have this joy, I don't want it just for me. I want it for you. And I know that you have that joy by what you do. And if you're getting discouraged in what you're doing, I want to know so I can encourage you, which is why Paul is writing this letter in the first place. Because Epaphroditus, who is the one he is going to send back to them, is someone that the church in Philippi sent to Paul. Paul's in jail. The church in Philippi sent Epaphroditus to help him. He has helped him. He has put his life at risk helping Paul. And now Paul is sending him back to them because he wants to encourage them. And as we see this unfold, all you see is this constant. Paul has joy. He's received joy. And he's interested in them receiving joy. Okay? In Philippians 2:19, he says, "If the Lord Jesus is willing, I hope to send Timothy to you soon for a visit. Then he can cheer me up by telling me how you are getting along." So see how I'm interested in how you're doing. I can't really know how you're doing, so I'm hoping, and if Jesus will let me, I'm hoping to send Timothy there so that he can see how you're doing, and he can come back and tell me. And why? Because I'm interested. Maybe nobody else cares what God is doing in your lives out there in Philippi, but I care. Why? My joy depends on it. My joy depends that I get to hear how God is using you. I know what fuels a fire. I don't throw water on a fire. I throw what fuels a fire on a fire. And what fuels the joy in my life is the joy in yours. But if I'm not interested in your life and how God is using you, I'm never going to fuel that joy in my own. Does that make sense? Okay, so this is what we're looking at. He's taking the time to, he's really given us this window into who he is. How did he make it through all those stonings? How did he make it through all those people who betrayed him and walked away from him and wouldn't even show up for him when he was put on trial? How did he get through that and keep going and never stop? How did he keep witnessing while he's in jail in Rome to where even Caesar's family is getting saved and the guards and their families are getting saved while Christians are being killed and thrown to the lions just less than a mile away from where he was? In a very dangerous place for Christians, especially for him. And so, where did he find this joy? He found it in other servants, people who were serving. Okay? In Hebrews 10:24 and 25, it says, Let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works, and let us not neglect our meeting together as some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that the day of his return is drawing near. So Jesus is coming back soon. We all know that. This world, God never lets this world get beyond what he's willing to let it get beyond. And we are not going to start creating life here soon by cloning people. God's not going to let that happen. Jesus is coming back before then. And we're on the cusp of it. Everything in the scriptures that's been predicted other than Jesus' second coming has come into play. And everything about his second coming that isn't something naturally from God, that someone in the world does, can be done today. For instance, two witnesses on the streets of Jerusalem telling people about Jesus during the tribulation, they're going to be killed, and the whole world is going to watch on. The whole world's watching soccer this week, all around the world. Every country is watching soccer, those that are interested in soccer. Well, if there's a whole army is coming against two people and he's destroying them, which is what's happening before they're allowed to kill him, believe me, the whole world will be watching that on their cell phones. So even the things in the scriptures that the people do are now doable, right? And so Jesus is coming back, and what does he want us to do? He wants us serving, and he wants us serving each other and living in a freedom that allows us to serve God, not serve people in the sense that we get our assignments from people, but serve God. We get our assignments from God, but we serve people because he's always having us serve others. Okay? So number one is I need to, number three, rather, is that I need to, I lost my place. I need to be interested in how others, we're on four now. But I got two fours. All right, number four on the front page, find a collaborator. Okay, that's the next thing that Paul talks about. I got them in the right order. All right. So I'm ready to serve God faithfully. I want to share my joy with you, and I'm interested in your joy. I'm interested in the things God's doing in your life that's causing you joy. And then number four, I find a collaborator. Now make sure you didn't write co-laborer down. This is not the same thing. However, co-laborer is part of us bringing joy to others. Don't get me wrong. And we do co-labor together, but co-laboring and collaborating is two different things, okay? So we both can go out and dig a ditch. But afterwards, when we decide and we get together and we discuss, well, what's the next ditch we should dig? And we decide together, and then we go. That's collaboration, right? So you understand the difference. Okay, so find a collaborator. So the next verse, in verse 20, Paul says this, I have no one else like Timothy who genuinely cares about your welfare. So think about this for a moment. What is he saying? He's saying, of all the people that I'm serving and all the people I'm sharing this joy with, there's this guy named Timothy. And what makes him somebody I collaborate when it comes to serving you is that he genuinely cares about your welfare, just like I do. Okay? How many of you have children in children's ministry? Raise your hand. Every one of those people genuinely care about your kids or they would not be there. The things I'm teaching you at Grace, I've known since we started, and I've known God's heart, and he never wants us filling slots to minister to children with people who don't care about the children. Okay? Listen to me. I would rather have a grandmotherly person who isn't even saved that cares about your child than a Christian who really doesn't care about your child, but hey, it's the only place I can serve because it's all I'm available for, or I want to serve in that ministry because I like the person who's in charge of it. I don't want that person taking care of your children. Even a lost person who cares for your children is better than a saved person who doesn't. Amen? But that isn't what we do either. Because if you're lost and you want to take care of children, I'm going to introduce you to Jesus so that he can take care of them through you. Which is why we do church. So that we all can serve Jesus, right? And so the good that we do is no longer the good that we do. It's the good that Jesus does through us, right? Which is why we have 101, 201, 301 class. And I encourage you, if you've not been to 101, come this Saturday, sign up today, and show up this Saturday, and you'll get a good view of who we are as a church. How our commitment to Christ and our commitment to each other and how we do things here at Grace. We do it that we expect and we know that I'm not going to be successful if I don't have collaborators. So I've got associate pastors here at this church. And even when I was the only pastor of this church, I had collaborators. People who didn't just come to church, but who actually loved you and cared about you as much as me. But they also had one other thing going for them that others did not. And that's what Paul says in the next two verses in Philippians 2, 21 and 22. He says, all the others care only for themselves and not for what matters to Jesus Christ. I don't want to put somebody with your children that is there because it's giving them some kind of an ego trip or because of your appreciation or because of the church's appreciation. That's how you need to tell people thank you. You need to tell people thank you or they're not going to serve. Well, if they're serving for a thank you, they're not going to serve anyway. I don't serve for a thank you. Paul didn't serve for a thank you. Jesus didn't serve for a thank you. I get this all the time. Satan wants to beat me down because, I didn't say thank you. I didn't say thank you to those who went out to the place out there in Loveland to feed the homeless this past Wednesday. I got to serve with you. And was I joyful? Absolutely. I love serving with you guys. I had a great time. Did I get tired? Yes. Did I want to go home? Yes. But I was joyful. Part of it was showed up in an outward expression. Part of it showed up with me sticking it out and continuing and making sure that I continued to work the whole time I was there. But I was co-laboring with other people who cared about those people and were there because of what mattered to Jesus. Not because they were going to get some kind of a kudo at church for going, right? That's where my joy is. Say, Bob, why do you serve in so many places? Why were you here? You didn't have to be here. Other people were doing the electrical last night. Why did you come in? Just to serve with them, just to be around them. I could have been sitting at home watching football or golf, but I decided I would rather be around people who are serving God. Why? Because it fuels my joy. And guess what you need on a morning when a pastor is preaching a sermon? A pastor who has joy. Because you see me when I was fighting to get that joy, I tell you. You will. I can't preach 52 sermons and not be wore out on one of them or two of them or 10 of them, depending on what's going on in your life or the church, depending on what's going on in the family, right? And I want you to learn these things. I want you to know that me having people like Pastor Dave, Pastor Shan, you know, people like David Anderson, people like Carolyn, people like Carolyn's parents, you know, people like Michelle singing, who sings up here, or people like Mike. First time I've been in that band, and I've been in this band for 20-some years, first time somebody turned around and said, I love you, after we played the first set, was Mike a couple weeks ago. Just turned around and said, I love you, Bob. He's only been coming to church 3 weeks. You know, I'm going, yes. You know, I'm going to go preach now. You see what I'm saying? This is what we're here for. We're not here to decide for ourselves what we're going to choose and not choose. We've already chosen. That's why we're here. Jesus, I want to grow. I want you to speak to me today, and I want to adjust to you today, because I will not grow if I don't hear you, and then I still won't grow if I don't adjust. Amen? We all know that much from the scriptures? Right. And so here, if you're going to, as you're serving and you're sharing this joy, don't you think it's a greater sharing, level of sharing, when you're sharing with someone you're collaborating with? Absolutely. Absolutely. So in the Christmas play, we got Chase that's leading the music portion of it. We got Shan that's leading the play portion of it. And we got Kevin that's leading the message. He's going to tie it all in with the gospel at the end. And I want them to collaborate together. And if they can't get along, that's more of an issue to me than what the service looks like. Because you see, you got, not just you, but Christmas Eve services, we bring twice as many as you in here. We'll have twice as many between the two services. And it's the one time that we get them, other than Easter. One of two. And it's a celebration time, not thinking about death, but thinking of life and giving. And Easter, we're thinking about death and resurrection and sin and those kinds of things. Not that God isn't going to bring us to a point of sin, and dealing with our sin, because he's going to share the gospel on that. But the season for the people who are walking in is different, is what I'm saying. And so they're coming in to get the Christmas, the real Christmas, you know, feeling, like they had when they were growing up. By the way, how many of you remember growing up with piano and choir and organ and traditional Christmas hymns? Anybody? All right. Sunday night, the 18th of December, right here, that's what we're doing. And that's why we're doing it. I want you to come and enjoy that time. I also want you to invite anybody over the age of 50 to come that you know. Because it's been a while, unless they're in a traditional church, it's been a while since they've been in that environment. And you know what? If I get into an environment that is comfortable to me because I've been in it before and I got close to Jesus, well, I'm going to get close to Jesus a whole lot more easier if that environment replicates that. In other words, what am I doing? I want a service that on Christmas Eve that will minister to the people in the community that I know are coming. And I want something on that Sunday ministering to people who aren't coming because they know there's drums and guitars and they're just not into loud music and that kind of thing. Why? Because they matter. Because they matter. Not me. They matter. And God, and I want to create an environment where they can say, I feel the presence of Jesus right now. And then they want to not ever leave it and never want that feeling to go away, that sense of knowing that Jesus is with them. All others care for only for themselves and not for what matters to Jesus. But you know how Timothy has proved himself like a son with his father. He has served me in preaching the good news. He has collaborated with me in your life and in others. In fact, in the very writing of this letter, it's probably Timothy who's writing it, and Paul, because of his eyesight, just sharing it. We know that because he actually says so in other letters. And number five, trust God to use you to bring joy to others. Okay? So I'm serving God faithfully, so I have this joy. I share that my joy with you. I'm interested. things you're doing with God that are bringing you joy. From time to time, we become collaborators as we serve together. Some we just serve together. Other times we are actually leading that service, and we're collaborating. Two of you at work that are Christians, you're both there, and there's a lost person who's going through a divorce or something. Are you there for God, who wants to reach that lost person in the lowest moment of their life, or are you there for yourself? What if there's one other Christian? Aren't you more bold? Aren't you more willing to say something and say, hey, you know what? When I go through things like that, I lean on Jesus. Do you know Jesus, right? But what if you or two of you got together first and actually said, how can we help this person walk with Jesus and find Jesus and follow Jesus through this? Hopefully to restore the marriage, but if not, that they will stand the way that we would stand, with peace and with joy through this whole process with God. And you collaborate together. That's when you get it. It's not about church, guys. It's about every day of my life serving God and yours. And then we find joy in that, and we share that joy with each other. We care that we're joining God in other people's lives. And we care that we're finding people who will collaborate with us, because Jesus always sent people out by two, collaborating. Which house do we stop at? Do we brush our feet off, or do we stay here? Collaboration is, why did Jesus have three that he talked to more than the others? Collaboration. The ones, as Paul said, the ones whose hearts are like yours towards that group of people. They care about the people, that person, and I care about that person. What matters to Jesus in that person's life matters to me and matters to them. And these are the people I'm going to be a collaborator with. And I am a collaborator with meaning in this church, because they do have the same heart that I have for you. And they do, and what matters to Jesus does matter to them, and you don't see it what they do here, you see it what they do in their homes, and what they do in their workplaces, and what they do in their community. And those are the people that should be leading here at Grace. Don't you agree? Absolutely. So trust God to bring you joy, or to use you to bring joy to others. Philippians 2, 23, 24. Paul's writing this letter to Philippi, this church he had brought to the Lord people, and then he left, and then they started a church, right? And now he's hearing about what's going on there. They sent him Epaphroditus because they heard he was struggling in jail, and Epaphroditus has helped him. And he says to them in verse 5 about Timothy, I hope to send him, not Epaphroditus, but Timothy, his co-laborer, that I want to send him to you. And I am trusting that the Lord will soon, that I myself may come to see you. Do you see that? Circle the word trusting. Do you trust that God is going to use you at work? That might be why he's not worth using you at work. Do you trust God to use you in your home? That might be why he's not using you at home. Do you trust God to use you in the lives of your children? No, I'm hoping God will do it. No, God wants to use you. That's why he gave them to you, to raise them up in the way they should go. Amen? But do you trust that he'll do it? Do you trust that while in this moment where you don't know what to do, do you trust him enough to do whatever he tells you to do? You know? And to handle it the way he wants you. They may need a scolding. They may also need reassurance. He may want to open up your eyes as to why they did it, because why they did it is much more impactful for their future than whatever discipline you can give them because they did it. Do you follow? Only God can be this guide in our lives. So serving God is something I practice at home. In fact, I have more practice at home than anywhere else, serving God. And, by the way, I never can serve God without first denying myself. It's never my go-to thing. So, are we clear on this? How do I find that joy? I've got to serve God faithfully. I've got to share my joy with you. I've got to be interested in how God uses you. I need collaborators in my life to help me become and stay focused and to help me become a better servant. And then I need to know that God is going to use me in other people's lives. In other words, I don't need to be someone looking for someone who will collaborate with me. I need to realize that God's going to send me to someone who needs someone to collaborate with. You follow? That's what that means. The two letters co-tells us that. It's not Bob getting someone to work with him. It's Bob getting someone and then Bob being that someone needs help with, right? So you got to be both. And then trusting God. And the way I do that is I trust that God is going to send me to others to help them get started and help them do their ministry. All right, so how do I bring joy other servants, since I trust that God is going to bring me to other servants. And basically this whole process of bringing them joy, that I'm part of that process that God is bringing into your life as you serve him. I hope that I am. I pray that I am. I want to be. So what am I doing? This is all I'm doing. It's all Paul was doing. It's all Jesus was doing, okay, to bring joy to other servants. Number one, be Christ to them. Be Christ to them. Goes without saying. Don't be Bob to them. Don't be Dad to them. Don't be husband to them. Don't be boss to them. Don't be servant to them. Be Christ to them. Because if I'm serving you because I'm serving you, Christ isn't involved. But if I'm serving you because I'm serving Christ, Christ is involved. You get it? This is why Jesus said, don't just minister to your own friends and families. Pagans do that. Any pastor in this church who doesn't care about the last person that walked through this door as much as he cares about the person that's been here the longest is not fit to serve God in this church. Would you agree? Or do you want me to find somebody to only find a few friends and serve them? What do you want? You want one who will love that person, that new person, by the way. How many of you are first-timers? Don't raise your hands. Whoever you are, you can raise your hands when you become more comfortable. God loves you, and we love you, and we can't say we're serving God. If you don't know, we're here to serve you, but we're not here to give you what you want. We're here to give God what he wants, and he wants you to be loved, and he wants you to be included, and he wants you to grow spiritually. He wants you to be able to deny yourself, take up your cross every day, and follow Jesus. He wants your life to be full of opportunities that he gives you to join him in the lives of the people, so that the difference you make won't just be for this lifetime. It'll be forever. The difference that God makes in those friendships that you serve him in are going to be much different. You're not going to see one thing you ever did with a friend on this earth when the reason you did it was selfish 100 years from now. But everything you did in a friend's life because Jesus asked you to do, you'll see it forever. And so will they, and you and they both will be praising God for letting you be a part of that. You for letting you be the one who administered that love and that grace, and them because you, instead of loving them with your love, love them with the love of God. So think about that. This is not just how do I train pastors. This is how do we get to this joy that Paul says, I want you to have and share in that joy. The one that Jesus said, I want you to have my joy. And that's why he told you to remain in me, right? So in Philippians 2:25, this is what Paul says. If you want to be Christ to another servant, he says it this way. Meanwhile, I thought I should send Epaphroditus back to you. Now, this is the one that they had sent to him to serve him while he was in jail. He said these things about him. Number one, and write this down, he is a true brother. Write that down on that first blank. Then he says he's a co-worker. Write that down. Remember, Timothy's a collaborator. Epaphroditus is a co-worker. But he's also what? A fellow soldier. He's facing the same enemy I am. In fact, it's probably more risky for him because he can easily be picked up off the streets and thrown into the ring with the lions like all the other Christians that were being pulled off the streets in Rome and everywhere else or during that time. Right? And so he's saying he was a fellow soldier with me. And then the last line, you get the fourth one. And he was a messenger to help me in my need. He was a servant to me. So if you want to be a Christ to somebody, you want to be Christ to your wife, then treat her as a true sister in Christ. Don't think you know, you have an in with Christ that she doesn't. Let her be faithful to her master as you are faithful to yours. Encourage her in her walk. Don't make her do what you're doing, but encourage her to find and see what God is doing in her life and encourage her to go after those things, and vice versa. I know women, we want our husbands to come to church, but believe me, that never saved anybody. But if they met Jesus while they were here, then they got saved. Amen? And if they began to follow Jesus, their life began to change. They began to look like Jesus. And then Jesus himself, by the way, Paul's saying this, but Jesus should be saying this about you and me. Bob is my true brother. Bob is my co-worker. Bob is a fellow soldier with me. He suffers many times to do and say what I'm telling him to do and say, and he continues to serve me faithfully. That's how you are Jesus to somebody who's a servant. We know what Jesus looks like because he's asking it of us, and we know when we see it in you. And listen to me. I know you don't need a thank you, but thank you for all of you who are these things to me. And you are. I wouldn't be here today if God hadn't used you in my life to help me find my joy when circumstances is trying to keep me from finding it. Galatians 5:13 says, "You have been called to live in freedom, my brothers and sisters, but don't use your freedom to satisfy your sinful nature. Instead, use your freedom to serve one another in love." And so if you're saying what God wants you to say and doing what God wants you to do in each other's life, you will be serving one another in love. Amen? Okay, so I got to be Christ. If I want to bring joy into your life, I need to be Christ defined as Paul defined it. Then I need to, number two, care about your welfare. I need to actually care about your welfare. How are you doing? Now, for you and me, how many of you have said, "How are you doing?" and you really didn't think past the question? Waiting for the fine so that you can move on to what you really wanted to talk about. Or like me, since I never have anything else to talk about, if we're not talking about God, I wonder what you're going to say next. After we get done with how you're doing and fine, you're going to have to figure out where the conversation goes after that. Unless it's about Jesus, and then I won't let you say anything for the next 5 minutes. Because that's all I want to talk about. That's the only thing where I can't stop talking, where I can't stop teaching, where I could preach. You guys leave, I have to really pay attention to the Spirit saying, "It's time, Bob." Or you'd be here for 4 or 5 hours. Ask anybody who's ever come into my office who wanted to learn something. I won't stop. Why? Because that's how God has gifted me, but God has gifted you in other ways. And he wants you to find what those things are, and those are the things you never want to stop because they bring you a joy you can't find anywhere else. Philippians 2:26, 27, "I am sending him because he has been longing." He's talking about Epaphroditus. He's sending him with this letter. He's saying, "I am sending him because he has been longing to see you, and he was very distressed that you heard that he was ill, and he certainly was ill. In fact, he almost died. But God had mercy on him and also on me so that I would not have one sorrow after another." And so you see this caring about Epaphroditus and this knowledge that Paul had that the servants in Philippi who had sent him also cared that he was ill and would care that he was ill. And so this is something he thinks that it should be normal for people who serve God, that we actually care about each other. Oh boy, figure that. We serve a God that makes sense, don't we? "Bob, I want you to serve me, but don't tell me you're serving me if you don't love the ones I'm having you serve." Right? "Oh God, I thought you wanted me to lead them." Yeah, by example. By example, through your service. That's how you lead. Didn't Jesus say that? The greatest among you will be the one who serves the most. Isn't that what he said? Absolutely. Not that we should be seeking greatness, but we should be seeking the best life that we possibly can have, and that is serving one another. So care about their welfare. Number three, help them expand their service. Don't just care about their service. Help them expand. I want their joy to increase. I want them to expand their service. Okay? So people come up to me and say, "Hey, God told me that, or I had this opportunity to," Melissa, and I know she's watching online. Melissa came up to me a few months ago, early in the summer, and said, "God has given me this opportunity, given us, our church, this opportunity to feed the homeless on the fifth Wednesday, whenever there's a fifth Wednesday." And I said, "Okay. Well, could you make it happen?" It's like, "No." I said, "Who do you know? Who do you know that's interested in people who are going hungry in this church?" She hadn't even thought about it. Her first thought was, "I go to Pastor Bob. He's the pastor. We can't do something here unless the pastor says so." No, that's another church. That's not this church. You can do anything God tells you to do, you can do whether I bless it or not. And we'll take it up 100 years from now. If it's not biblical, then I might say something. If it's ungodly, I might say something. And if it's selfish, certainly I will say something. but not to shut it down, but to, so that you don't miss the joy in it. And so I didn't want her to miss the joy in it, so I said, you go. There's people in here that you know. I know there's people in this church that you know that would care about this as much as you do. She said, yeah, go help them expand their service. Go tell them about it. It doesn't have to become an official Grace Community Church thing. Why does it have to be are they requiring it that it be a Grace Community Church thing? No, most of their volunteers aren't saved, I know, because when I work with them, they don't want to talk about Jesus. They don't want to pray with us. Okay? So I know they let people who aren't Christians serve there. It's not just churches. And so she did. And she built a team. And then people on that team moved and couldn't go. And you know what? She never comes back to me. Except letting me know, like she's learned from me. She'll text me like she did this last week or 2 weeks ago. That she wasn't going to be in town. She says, I'm not going to be in town. I'm going to be in Florida. I just wanted to let you know that we're doing it this week, this Wednesday, if you'd like to be a part of it. But I could have said no, but I said yes. Why? Because God said yes, and I said yes, and it's kind of like what we do every day, right? This is what we're talking about. And so I got to be a part of, because I told God, I've decided I've only got so many Christmases left, you know. I want every Christmas season to be my best one ever. I wanted this one to be my best one ever. So I'm doing a lot of things this Christmas I did not do last year with my family, with you, and it's because I want it to be my best Christmas ever. And God goes, well, Bob, shouldn't you want it to be their best Christmas ever, too? Yes. So teach them how to serve. And by the way, get ready, because you're going to serve more than you're going to experience. Does that make sense? It's not that you're going to go Christmas caroling. You're going to contact people who might have the same heart, and you're going to make it happen. Actually, I've never made anything happen. I've just found the people that God had interested in it, and we made it happen because we said yes to Jesus, who is actually the one who made it happen. He is the one who works in us to both will, decide we want to make it happen, and then do, right? And these are the things that bring him glory. I want to help you get to be more like Paul. I want to help you get to be more like Jesus. I want you to help me get to be more like Jesus, because I cannot be like Jesus if I'm running the show. Philippians 2:28 again. So I am all the more anxious to send him back to you, for I know you will be glad to see him, and then I will not be so worried about you. And finally, today, number four, joyfully embrace others who serve. Joyfully embrace others who serve. Every week we have new people who come in here. And every week we have people who either have never served in their church before, love you, and we're glad that you're here, and we hope that you will see Jesus enough to want to follow him, and that you will grow here, and that you would end up being someone who is serving him in your home, in your workplace, everywhere, not because of us, but because of Christ. But we also have people who have served in their other churches who come in here, and they think, oh, I can't serve. That's not true. You can serve here. Well, can I preach? Maybe not up here, but let's get together. We'll find a place where you can preach. I didn't start on a stage in front of a church. I started in front of a bunch of people in a wheelchair that couldn't move. They were stuck. And I'll get you in a home that's filled with people who need to be loved with God's love, and very few people willing to take God's love to them. You want to preach to somebody. You want to teach somebody. Preach and teach someone who is hungry for God. Not just to know more about God, but to experience his presence and his love. And your preaching and your teaching or your visiting, whatever you're doing, will take on a whole nother perspective, because God is going to make sure through you they get it. I promise you. We want you to know, yes, you still need to go to 101, 201, 301 before we give you sheep. Why? Because we want you to know what we're teaching the sheep. Everybody teaches different things out there. We don't want to know what those things are. We trust that the things that are from God in your previous church are the things that are from God in this church. And so we're good with all of that. But we want you to know and make sure that those things line up with what we teach here at Grace, because a house divided cannot stand, and you're a servant, and expect that God is going to use you and expect that God is going to ask us as pastors to give sheep to you at some point. But if you don't care what the people that are going through and how we're teaching and growing those people, then you don't care to serve as a leader at Grace. Well, then I don't need to go. I don't want to be a leader at Grace. I don't need to go to one-on-one. Yeah, you don't need. If you don't want to learn what it means to be committed to Christ, committed to a church family, if you don't need to know or care to know the habits that are necessary for spiritual growth that we teach in 201, if you don't care to know how God has uniquely shaped you to serve people in your home, in the world, and in your church, then you don't need 301. And if you don't care how to use your network, how it's not just you, but you have collaborators, you have co-workers, you have fellow soldiers, if you don't, you have all kinds of tools at your disposal to bring into any situation at any time to help you bring Christ into that situation, then you don't need 401. So in other words, I don't need 101, 201, 301, 401 if all I'm going to do is hear sermons every week for the next 50 weeks. But I do need those things if I'm going to become part of Grace Community Church's leadership, the ones that God uses to serve, to be a servant that isn't serving self, but is serving God. Can I still serve? Absolutely. We tell you right from 101, if God's asking you to serve, serve. He's asking you to teach, teach. But we're not sending sheep to you until we're certain that you're teaching biblically. Right? We're accountable to God for that. All right? But we want to expand your service. We want you to serve God here. And we want, I guarantee you, one of you is new to this church, and God will use you more in this year than someone who's been here the last 10 years because they've already decided they've got as much as they want from Grace and from God. I promise you. I see this every year. But don't let a lie, we don't want you to serve, keep you from serving. I hope this message shows you we want just the opposite. We want you to not only serve, we want you to serve better and more often than you did before. Why? Because God wants me to serve better and more often than I had before. He always gives the extra assignments to the ones who are already serving. Always. And that's how we do things here. Philippians 2:29 and 30, welcome him in the Lord with great joy. Embrace him, right? And show your appreciation, for he risked his life for the work of Christ and was at the point of death while trying to do for me the things you couldn't do because you were far away. So I embraced him when he came. I used him when he came. He was very helpful to me. He was a co-laborer, right? He was a fellow soldier. He was a servant to me. And now I'm sending him back. Embrace him. Even though he hasn't been with you experiencing what you've been going through, embrace him. He's coming back to you. Philippians 4:1, therefore, it's up here, not on your notes. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stay true to the Lord. I love you and I long to see you. Dear friends, this is Paul at the end of this letter. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stay true to the Lord. I love you and I long to see you. Dear friends, for you are my joy and the crown I receive for my work. You are my joy. I want to be your joy. I want us always to be a joy to each other, because then even when we are having a bad day, we will not quit on each other, and we will continue to love each other. 1 Peter 1, 7 and 8, to finish up, you love Christ even though you have never seen him. Though you do not see him now, you trust him. Circle the word trust. You trust him, and you rejoice with a glorious and inexpressible joy. If you're trusting God, then you're serving God. Would you agree? If you're trusting God, you are serving God. And if you are trusting God, you have access to this gift. You rejoice. It doesn't mean you can find it. It means you are in it. You are rejoicing with a glorious and inexpressible joy. So this, yay, doesn't even do it justice. Right? Because it's inexpressible. So I just pray that this Christmas season, you'll take what you learned today and you'll apply it at home. You'll apply it at work. I pray that if you're truly going to follow Jesus at work, you look around and see if there's anybody else. You say, well, I don't know anyone. When I wasn't following Jesus, I didn't know anybody. I worked as an air traffic controller, had 200 and some people I'd been working with for 10 years. I knew some were Christians, but usually because everybody was making fun of them. But the minute I started reading my Bible and all I cared about was Jesus instead of money, everyone in that place figured it out really quick. And within 4 weeks, I'd say, I knew over 50 Christians who had come up to me and wanted to know what the heck was going on in my life because of all the joy I was getting when I was visiting people in the hospital. I was reading the Bible. I was studying to learn how to share the gospel. And what it was doing to me was evident to the Christians that all of a sudden I was someone safe that they could approach. Not only that, that God was using and bringing the things we talked about into their life, and I didn't even know that's what he was doing. I can preach about it now. I lived it then, and I hope I've lived it every day since. And I hope you do as well. Let's pray. Father God, thank you so much. Some of us minister to different, well, all of us minister to different people. Some of us minister to drug addicts, and some of us minister to homeless, and some of us minister to, you know, people who have a lot of power. Some of us minister to people who feel like they've got everything they need and they don't know you. And the way that we minister really isn't important, or that we minister really is important, until we know you want us to join you in their lives. Father God, I pray that we will keep ourselves ready. We will wake up in the morning and we'll say, Lord, what are we going to do today? And if today we come across a friend who's troubled with drugs, that we can help them.